Well, thank you all for coming. I think you all of you have the raffle card, right? Good. So we'll do a little, I'll collect them at the end of the night, and then we'll do a raffle, and then you can take home this book. So we shall begin. During the first year of the pandemic, I went on a journey to trace the impact that Richard Wagner had on the James Joyce's Ulysses and Marcel Proust's In Search of Lost Time. In particular, I wanted to demonstrate, and not merely assert, Wagner's impact on these two seminal literary works of the early 20th century. The impact on which this evening's talk focuses is how Joyce and Proust used Wagner's concept of Leitmotiv, Endless Melody, and Gesamtkunstwerk. They used these concepts in constructing Ulysses and In Search of Lost Time. To get us in the mood for this evening's talk and journey, we'll start off with a little bit of Wagner. We're going to hear about 15 seconds from Wagner's Ring. I know that hearing short excerpts from Wagner is painful, but to make matters worse, be forewarned that some of my excerpts will cut off abruptly. All right, this evening we'll be taking a journey together, visiting Wagner's musical home at Bayreuth, Dublin, the setting for Ulysses, that's the one on the left, told largely through the eyes, through the thoughts of Leopold Bloom, and Paris for the setting of much of In Search of Lost Time, as told through the memory of the narrator. Wagner, Joyce, and Proust will be our travel companions, and our travel guidebook will be my book, Three Pillars of Western Culture. During this presentation, we'll meet a variety of characters. In Ulysses, we'll meet Leopold Bloom, his wife Molly, and Bloom would be adopted son, Stephen Dedalus. In Search of Lost Time, we'll encounter, among others, the narrator, his mother, his grandmother, Albertine, and Monsieur de Chaluz. Ulysses and In Search of Lost Time are not easy books to read. Five lines into Ulysses, we encounter a sentence in Latin. And four pages into In Search of Lost Time, we can easily become overwhelmed with a 599-word sentence. We need aids in approaching Ulysses and In Search of Lost Time. Wagner will provide the structure for our approach to these two works. For those of you who have not made it through either work, I hope this presentation makes these two books more accessible and enjoyable for you. Please note, keep in mind that this presentation is not an overview of Ulysses or In Search of Lost Time. Wagner's impact on the arts from the latter half of the 19th century through the present is nearly endless. These include music, drama, poetry, and even cinema. In terms of acting as a cultural springboard, I would say that Wagner's Tannhäuser and Tristan and Isolde were the stimuli for the birth of the modern by showing what could be expressed in music and in art. My focus, however, will be on Wagner's impact on literature. In Joyce's Ulysses and in Proust's In Search of Lost Time, hereafter shortened to In Search of, we see a shift from plot to an exploration into the consciousness and unconscious lives of the characters. Instead of an omniscient narrator, we have grossly flawed and error-prone narrators. Instead of heroes and heroines, we have anti-heroes and anti-heroines. And instead of a linear narrative through the stream of consciousness and internal monologue writing, we get multispatial and multi-temporal events occurring simultaneously. To further narrow our scope, I'm focusing on how Joyce and Proust employed Wagner's concepts of Leitmotiv, Endless Melody, and Gesamtkunstwerk into their novels. Joyce and Proust were intimately familiar with Wagner's operas and theoretical writings, and both Ulysses and In Search of have multiple references to Wagner and to his operas. For example, in episode 16 of Ulysses, Stephen Dedalus and Leopold Bloom are searching for common ground. I quote, "So they turned onto chatting about music, a form of art for which Bloom, as a pure amateur, possessed the greatest love, as they made tracks arm in arm across Beresford Place. Wagnerian music, though confessedly grand in its own way, was a bit too heavy for Bloom and hard to follow at the first go-off." End of quote. And Proust's longest exploration and exposition of art and music in particular focuses on Wagner's music. Forgive me for not providing an illustration on this point from In Search of. My rationale is that even the simplest idea in Proust goes on for pages and pages. Counting the reference to Wagner is a bit easier. There are 106 Wagnerian references within the pages of In Search of. Their knowledge of Wagner and the employing Wagnerian references clearly is not sufficient to show that Proust used the Wagnerian techniques of leitmotif, endless melody, and Gesamtkunstwerk. Providing this evidence is a central theme of my book and the heart of this evening's presentation. For those who do not recognize our three artists, the person on the left is Richard Wagner, who died in 1883. In the center is James Joyce, born in 1882, and on the right, Marcel Proust, born in 1871. So you see that Joyce and Proust lived and wrote a generation after Wagner's death. During this period, Wagnerism, and what some would call Wagnermania, was at its pinnacle. Women played very important roles in each of their respective lives, whether for emotional support, financial support, or both. For the sake of time, I'm going to reduce their very complex lives and influences to a few terse sentences. Admittingly, I'm not doing them justice, but hopefully not a gross injustice. Minna Planner was Wagner's first wife. She lived with Wagner through his financially toughest years. Minna wanted stability. Wagner gave her chaos. After 25 years of a rocky marriage, they parted ways in 1861 while they were living in Zurich. Keep in mind Zurich when we discuss Mathilde Wesendonck. They never divorced, and Wagner continued to support her financially. She died in 1866. Mathilde Wesendonck, if not the other woman, was the final woman as far as Minna was concerned. Living on the Wesendonck property in Zurich, Minna wanted romance. Wagner wanted romance. Mathilde wanted to be Wagner's patron. Wagner left Zurich, and Mathilde stayed with her husband, but not before Tristan and Isolde was conceived. Cosima Wagner, 24 years younger than Wagner, was married to Hans von Bülow at the time Cosima began her love affair with Wagner in Triebschen. Cosima wanted someone to worship, and Wagner gave her that someone to worship, namely him. She became Wagner's scribe, and upon Wagner's death, the heir to Bayreuth. Joyce's women. Nora Barnacle was Joyce's lover and soulmate and eventual wife. Their first date on Thursday, June 16, 1904, the date on which Ulysses takes place, is now known as Bloomsday. Shortly after June 16th, they ran off to Paris. Joyce's father wittingly said of Nora Barnacle that she'll stick to you. She did stick to him with him through many difficult times. For those of you who know Ulysses, Nora is a model for Penelope. Nora said yes to Joyce. What did I say? Okay, Nora said yes to Joyce. Joyce's Women, Part Two. Wagner had the Wesendonks and King Ludwig for financial support. Joyce had Harriet Weaver. Harriet Weaver was a wealthy patron of the arts, and Joyce gladly accepted her money throughout his life. It is estimated that in today's dollars, Weaver gave the Joyce family around $1 million. On the right side, we see Sylvia Beach in front of her famous bookstore and lending library, Shakespeare and Company. Sylvia Beach had a bookstore, and Joyce needed someone to publish Ulysses. He sailed in, and she published Ulysses. Sylvia Beach coined the term Bloomsday for June 16, 1904. Marcel Proust had an unusual mother fixation, and his mother had an unusual son fixation. At age 34, he inherited about $5 million in today's dollars. Proust had the financial independence to write In Search of Lost Time. I, too, have a woman to whom I am indebted for everything. That person, of course, is my wife, Kathy. Dante had Beatrice, Wagner had Cosima, Leopold Bloom had Molly, and the narrator in Proust's novel had Albertine. I have Kathy. I clearly won hands down. So now let's get to work. Here is a chart that we're going to complete during the course of this presentation. On the left side, we have the words Leitmotif, Endless Melody, and Gesamtkunstwerk. On the upper row, we have Wagner, Joyce, and Proust. I'm going to provide three illustrations of musical leitmotifs from Wagner. Then I'll provide two literary leitmotifs from Ulysses and two from In Search Of. Next, one illustration of Endless Melody from Wagner, two illustrations from Joyce, and four from Proust. Why four from Proust and only two from Joyce? Ulysses has about 225,000 words, and In Search Of has nearly 1.3 million words. So that gets Proust a couple of more illustrations. Finally, one illustration of Gesamtkunst's work from Wagner, and a general discussion of how Joyce and Proust incorporated this principle of a synthesis of the arts, where the whole is greater than the sum of their parts, into their literary works. Here are the three leitmotifs we'll be briefly discussing from Wagner. Broadly speaking, leitmotifs are short pieces of music that have an audible identity, they recur throughout the piece, and are associated with some extra musical element, often a person, object, event, or emotion. Let's hear a 15-second excerpt that we will all recognize. The Valkyrie riding motif is seared into our brains such that whenever we hear even a few notes of it, we know who is coming. Next, we'll see a 45-second excerpt from Gotterdammerung. This is it's a Bayreuth Festival Orchestra in 1991, and there you have some other information about them. We know from the music that a Valkyrie is in the sky even before Brunhilde fully realizes it. I hear the motif about 13 seconds within this 45-minute excerpt. I think we are confident that a Valkyrie will soon appear. Why? Because we have heard that leitmotif earlier in the opera. There are many definitions of how Wagnerian leitmotifs are characterized and how they function. Thomas Mann described Wagnerian leitmotifs, as linking the past with the future and the future with the past. Geoffrey Swan, who I think we all know and to whom we are all very indebted for our appreciation of Wagnerian leitmotifs, describes leitmotifs as pregnant with meaning, in that they carry memories of the past and point to the future. I find it helpful to think of Wagnerian leitmotifs as tridirectional. They point the hearer and reader backward and forward through objective space and time, that's a horizontal arrow, and inward to the subjective or psychological experience of the character or situation, that's the arrow's vertical line. To foreshadow where we're going, those familiar with Joyce's Ulysses know that Leopold Bloom hears the jingling of carriage wheels throughout the day. Our experience of the jingling exists on two different planes. First, on the horizontal plane, we go back in space and time to hear Molly's bed jingling at 8 a.m., and also into the future at 4 p.m., when Molly and Blazes Boylan are causing Leopold and Molly's bed to jingle during their not-so-secret assignation. And second, and on the vertical plane, we move into Bloom's inner space, into his conscious life, as Bloom associates the jingling sound with Molly's adulterous affair. Bloom tries to escape his thoughts. No, not now, don't think. We experience both the objective carriage going down the street, the horizontal arrow, and also Bloom's subjective suffering, the vertical arrow. Those familiar with In Search Of recall the narrator and Albertine continually lie to each other. That's a horizontal arrow. The vertical arrow represents their conscious or unconscious reacting to the other's lies. The narrator is driven to a condition of neuroses, maybe even psychoses. At times, Albertine seems to enjoy torturing the narrator. Objectively, the lies appear similar. Psychologically, they are very different. Now let's see how this tridirectionality plays out in Wagner. Many of you are familiar with Lohengrin's forbidden question motif in the opera Lohengrin. In English, the forbidden question translates into something like, "Don't ask me where I'm from, my name, or my nature." We hear it 18 times during the opera. Musically, it transforms into different sounds, eventually intermingling with Ortrud's theme. Dramatically, the forbidden question is doing many different jobs. A command, a request. It's heard as the seeds of doubt are planted into Elsa's mind by Ortrud, and eventually becomes a fanfare of doom. Let's hear the first statement of the Frage Verbot. On the left-hand side, you can see the music, and on the right-hand side, the English translation. Those familiar with this scene from Lohengrin know that Lohengrin is speaking to Elsa, but he's also addressing King Henry and the citizens of Brabant. The king and the citizens' fate are tied to Elsa's decision. Therefore, Lohengrin's decree is both a public and private assertion. We'll hear a 35-second audible excerpt. You can follow along with the score. A few seconds later, Lohengrin repeats the words, but with a slightly different music in the B section. The second time Elsa hears Lohengrin's words, she willingly accepts it as creating a moral bond between her and Lohengrin. This motif takes on an additional dramatic function. In this 30-second excerpt, we'll see Ortrud absorbing the motif, soon to turn it into a weapon, a knife to sow doubt in Elsa, leading eventually to Elsa's destruction. The point is that this leitmotif exists on multiple planes, in the public sphere, the private sphere between Elsa and Lohengrin, and the internal or subjective sphere within Elsa's mind and Ortrud's mind. The leitmotif has different meanings depending on who is hearing it. Now, watch Ortrud in a few seconds. My third and last musical example shows how leitmotifs can morph into other leitmotifs. First the ring motif, and then the Valhalla motif, and then their transformation of one into the other. So here's a ring motif. This transformation from the sinister ring leitmotif to the majestic Valhalla leitmotif illustrates the idea of transformation or metamorphosis. Let's hear how this transformation or metamorphosis occurs in the ring, of the ring leitmotif into the Valhalla leitmotif. This excerpt is from The Ring Disc, an interactive guide to Wagner's ring cycle. I've highlighted in yellow what we should listen for, how the ring leitmotif sheds its bitterness as its harmony changes and as it moves from reeds to the violas to the horn. This is a 1:45 excerpt. Thank you. Metamorphosis is referred to and used by Joyce in Proust and Ulysses and In Search Of. Putting aside its significance, almost first thing in the morning, we hear Leopold and Molly Bloom discussing metempsychosis, which is how Molly reads and mispronounces the word metempsychosis. And on page 39 of In Search Of, which is like page one for a regular book, the narrator mentions for the first of many occurrences the word metamorphosis. Let's take stock of where we are. We have completed one of our eight squares. We will move fast, I promise, but understanding Wagner's use of leitmotifs is crucial to our story. Let's now look at some examples of how Joyce and Proust use literary leitmotifs in Ulysses and In Search Of. There are literally hundreds of leitmotifs I could use, ranging from a bar of soap that Leopold Bloom carries in his pocket throughout the day to Madame Putbus's maid that Proust's narrator fantasizes about throughout much of the novel. I have selected two from each work. But first, a few words about the bar of soap. I'm very grateful to Christopher Griffith. I don't see where he is. And oh, there he is. He's my instructor he's my only instructor of Ulysses. He teaches out of politics and prose. And he bought this bar of soap at Sweeney's Pharmacy, which is the place where Bloom bought the bar of soap in Ulysses. So the store is still open. And if you want to, you can come look at it, smell it. But please don't take it. We'll begin with two illustrations from Joyce's Ulysses, one relatively simple and a second more complex. Buck Mulligan is an example of a literary leitmotif of a person or character having the same significance in different settings. Buck Mulligan cannot not be noticed in Ulysses. Although one-dimensional, a mocker of everything sacred and secular, and incredibly obnoxious, his presence is ubiquitous. We'll hear a 50-second recording from the opening lines of Ulysses. We meet Buck Mulligan acting as a priest, mocking the Catholic Church and Catholic Mass, and pretending to exorcise the devil from Stephen. Only about the first 25 seconds are on the screen. The reason for this visual truncation is that part of the beauty of Ulysses is the sound of the words. They are closer to music than to text. Let's hear this 50-second excerpt.
Stately, plump Buck Mulligan came from the stairhead, bearing a bowl of lather on which a mirror and a razor lay crossed. A yellow dressing gown, ungirdled, was sustained gently behind him by the mild morning air. He held the bowl aloft and intoned,
"Intro ibor altare dei."
Halted, he peered down the dark, winding stairs and called up coarsely,
"Come up, Kinch! Come up, you fearful Jesuit!"
Solemnly he came forward and mounted the round gunrest. He faced about and blessed gravely thrice the tower, the surrounding country, and the awaking mountains. Then, catching sight of Stephen Dedalus, he bent towards him and made rapid crosses in the air, gurgling in his throat and shaking his head.
Buck Mulligan is one-dimensional. We are entertained but not surprised by what he says as he appears throughout the novel. For example, in episode 14 that takes place in a maternity ward, he informs his fellow medical students that he plans to buy an island where women will come to him and have sex with him. Buck Mulligan is a literary illustration of the audible Valkyrie writing motif, in the sense that when we hear a bit of it, we know who's coming. In Buck Mulligan's case, it's someone vulgar and demeaning. A more complex example of a literary leitmotif is the word throwaway. This leitmotif morphs into many different forms. On its face, each permutation has a different meaning, but carries the same dramatic significance. To keep things simple, I will only discuss the first two and ignore the third use of throwaway, a piece of paper that is a flyer announcing a talk by an evangelist. Some background is necessary. Both car and horse racing were a big deal in Dublin in 1904. On June 16, 1904, the Ascot Gold Cup horse race was taking place. Everyone was talking about it and betting money on the race. One of the horses was Throwaway, a 20-to-1 outsider. Enter Mr. Bloom, or rather exit Mr. Bloom, from a confectionery shop, coming out with a bar of soap for his wife Molly and a newspaper under his arm. We will listen to a 1 minute and 30 second excerpt from this scene.
He strolled out of the shop, the newspaper baton under his armpit, the cool wrapper soap in his left hand. At his armpit, Bantam Lyne's voice and hand said,
"Hello, Bloom. What's the best news? Is that a day's? Show us a minute."
Shaved off his moustache again, by Jove. Long, cold upper lip to look younger. He does look balmy. Younger than I am.
Bantam Lyne's yellow black nail fingers unrolled the baton.
"Wants a wash, too. Take off the rough dirt. Good morning. Have you used a pair of soap? Dandruff on his shoulders. Scalp wants oiling."
"I want to see about that French horse that's running today,"
Bantam Lyne said.
"Where the bugger is it?"
He rustled the pleated pages, jerking his chin on his high collar.
"Barber's itch. Tight collar, he'll lose his hair. Better leave him the paper and get shut of him."
"You can keep it,"
Mr. Bloom said.
"Ascot, Gold Cup. Wait,"
Bantam Lyons muttered.
"Half a mow, maximum the second."
"I was just going to throw it away,"
Mr. Bloom said. Bantam Lyons raised his eyes suddenly and leered weakly.
"What's that?"
his sharp voice said.
"I say you can keep it,"
Mr. Bloom answered.
"I was going to throw it away that moment."
Bantam Lyons doubted an instant, leering, then thrust the outspread sheets back on Mr. Bloom's arms.
"I'll risk it. Here, thanks."
And this begins permutations on the leitmotif throwaway that saturates what is now known as Bloom's Day. The horse race comes up in eating establishment, bars, hospitals, and brothels. Every time talk of the Gold Cup is mentioned, you cannot help but return to the above scene between Bloom and Bantam Lyons. The irony is that Bloom never gambles, has no idea about that day's horse race, and has no suspicion that everyone believes that he bet and won a lot of money on throwaway, on throwaway's 20-to-1 odds. Throwaway, in one form or another, appears dozens of times throughout the novel, and eventually morphs into a horrible display of anti-Semitism. A bit of Joycean humorous irony, Joyce reunites these two meanings of throwaway, a reference to the newspaper, and the horse throwaway. It's 1 a.m. in a cab station. Bloom is passing time reading the sports page of a newspaper about that day's Gold Cup race and notices that the horse throwaway won. As a brilliant display of tragic irony, an hour or so later, Bloom, now home, sees torn up racing tickets from that day's Gold Cup race on the kitchen counter. Those tickets were purchased by Blazes Boylan, Molly's lover. We know that those torn up pieces of paper need to be thrown away. Here is the point. Much of the drama and humor in Ulysses will be lost on us if we do not recognize the leitmotific function of throwaway, the first encounter of which occurred early in the novel. Now let's turn to two examples of literary leitmotifs from Proust in Search of Lost Time. The first will be relatively simple and the second more complex. The curé, or parish priest, occurs sporadically and is always understated. We don't even know his name other than as the curé. Yes, he is used to show the pedantic nature of one of the characters, but I don't believe that the novel would be radically altered if he never appeared in the novel. Yet, whenever we encounter the curé, we magically are reminded of many rather innocuous encounters with him in the early pages and throughout the book. I don't know how a character can involve so little drama and yet is so rich with reminiscence. I could be mistaken, but perhaps it's because the curé is the sole religious figure in the novel and thus makes a lasting impression. But whatever it is, mention of the curé moves the reader's memory throughout the space and time of the novel. Now let's turn to a more complex and thereby more interesting example, the kiss. In Search of Lost Time opens with the well-known sentence, "For a long time, I used to go to bed early." A few pages after that first sentence, we encounter the narrator's desire for his mother's goodnight kiss. Let's hear a 2-minute excerpt.
"My sole consolation when I went upstairs for the night was that Mama would come in and kiss me after I was in bed. But this goodnight lasted for so short a time. She went down again so soon that the moment in which I heard her climb the stairs and then caught the sound of her garden dress of blue muslin, from which hung little tassels of plaited straw, rustling along the double-doored corridor, was for me a moment of the keenest sorrow. So much did I love that good night that I reached the stage of hoping that it would come as late as possible, so as to prolong the time of respite during which Mama would not yet have appeared. Sometimes when, after kissing me, she opened the door to go, I longed to call her back and say to her, "Kiss me just once again." But I knew then she would at once look displeased, for the concession which she made to my wretchedness and agitation in coming up to me with this kiss of peace always annoyed my father, who thought such ceremonies absurd, and she would have liked to try to induce me to outgrow the need, the custom of having her there at all, which was a very different thing from letting the custom grow up of my asking her for an additional kiss when she was already crossing the threshold. And to see her look displeased destroyed all the sense of tranquillity she had brought me a moment before, when she bent her loving face down over my bed and held it out to me like a host for an act of communion in which my lips might drink deeply the sense of her real presence, and with it, the power to sleep.
Sections that are highlighted in yellow. A few pages later, we witness a second kiss scene, but this time, expanded and more highly dramatized version. It is fraught with the narrator's self-realization that his manipulating the situation to win his mother's kiss has resulted in his being labeled ill, and as someone who has no willpower. The kiss now becomes intermingled with desire and frustration, the sacred and the profane, assertions of his willpower and abandonment of his willpower. It represents a cacophony of emotions that result in his inability to start writing his novel and his inability to form healthy relationships with women. In this latter regard, there are several rather uncomfortable scenes later in the novel when during sex with his mistress, Albertine, he imagines his mother's kiss. You can follow along as I read the text. When it was Albertine's turn to bid me good night, kissing me on either side of my throat, her hair caressed me like a wing of softly bristling feathers. Incomparable were those two kisses of peace. Albertine slipped in my mouth, making me the gift of her tongue like the gift of a Holy Spirit, conveyed to me a viaticum, left me with the provision of tranquility, almost as precious as when my mother, in the evening at Cambrai, used to lay her lips upon my brow. For those who have made it to the end of the novel, in the closing pages, the narrator, now around 50, is speaking with his childhood love, Gilbrette, who now has a daughter of an unspecified age, but we know that she's young. We read, I looked at Gilbrette and did not think to myself, I would like to see her again. But I told her it would always give me pleasure to be invited to her to meet some young girls, but without harboring the intention of asking anything more of them than to reawaken in me the reveries and sorrows of earlier years, and perhaps, on some unlikely day, a chaste kiss. Throughout the novel, the narrator, end of quote. Throughout the novel, the narrator has an unhealthy need to possess, to control, to manipulate, to imprison others, particularly women. These diverse instances of possessiveness are encapsulated by the leitmotif of his desire for his mother's kiss. Missing these connections may not diminish our pleasure in reading Proust's novel, but it certainly does not enhance it. Our deeper appreciation of the novel's structure is lost if we do not recognize the leitmotific function of the kiss. We could spend hours discussing these and dozens or hundreds of other leitmotifs in Ulysses and In Search Of, but time demands that we move on to discussing Wagner's Endless Melody. But first, let's take stock of where we are in our matrix. We have completed three of our 6-8 boxes. Let's move on to discussing a discussion of Endless Melody. Having abandoned the traditional structure of arias, duets, and choruses, Wagner needed an organizing principle to bind his leitmotifs into a coherent structure. The resulting structure came to be known as his endless melody. They are neither endless nor, being composed of leitmotifs, necessarily melodic. Yet these endless melodies create coherent sections of music. Let us hear one that we probably all know. The melody is nearly 6 minutes long, kind of endless, and is held together by leitmotifs that tell the story of the Walsung. I listed the leitmotifs and the time when they appear. In the interest of time, I'll stop the recording after about 3 minutes. Sword motif. It's so hard to stop Wagner. It goes on endlessly, and we want it to. Now it's Joyce's turn. One way Joyce creates a literary endless melody is through his use of the stream of consciousness technique. The stream of consciousness technique in Ulysses occurs both in the public and private spheres. By public, I mean the swift exchange of dialogue, or bits of dialogue among groups of people that makes it almost impossible for the reader to know who is speaking or what is being said. It is basically a cacophony of sound. Yet, if you listen or read closely, each snippet of words makes enough sense to create a coherent scene. We will look at two examples of what I call private stream of consciousness, one by Bloom and one by Molly. In the first example, we hear Bloom thinking, "Penrose, that was that chap's name." So what's going on here? Earlier that day, Bloom was walking around Dublin thinking to himself, "What was the name of that priestly-looking chap who was always squinting in when passed? Weak eyes, woman. Stopped in Citron St. Kevin's parade. Pen something. Pen Dennis. My memory is going. Pen. Of course, it's years ago. Noise of the tram, probably." A bit later, he suddenly remembers the name Penrose. But there's more. As the name of that priestly-looking chap pops into his head, he is helping a blind person cross the street. He doesn't know that the blind person does, in fact, tune pianos, and will play a significant role in the Sirens episode later that day. Bloom thinks of various occupations that they could have, for example, tune pianos or embroider. Then he has what we would call a moral thought. People ought to help. Then he thinks about his wife, Molly. Then he circles back to the blind person he's helping cross the street. Let's hear this 30-second excerpt.
Penrose. That was that chap's name. Look at all the things they can learn to do. Read with their fingers, tune pianos. Oh, we are surprised they have any brains. Why, we think a deformed person or a hunchback clever if he says something we might say. Of course, the other senses are more. Embroider, plait baskets. People ought to help. Work basket I could buy. Molly's birthday. Hates sewing. Might take an objection. Dark men, they call them.
Bloom's snippets of thoughts flow from topic to topic, but they are snippets of leitmotifs. The leitmotifs in this excerpt primarily are Bloom's compassion as exemplified in helping the blind person. We have already seen and will continue to see illustrations of Bloom's humanity throughout the novel. And second, his thinking about his wife, Molly. Bloom's thoughts continually return to Molly. Similar to recognizing a musical leitmotifs, if you do not notice these recurrences within Bloom's thoughts and relate them to earlier events in the novel, Ulysses is still a good read. If you notice them, it's a great read. The 222,000 word, or nearly 2.5-hour recording tour de force of Stream of Consciousness or Endless Melody, is Molly's thoughts as she lays in bed drifting off to sleep. There is no punctuation, so I don't know why many scholars say that it's made up of 8 sentences. To me, it's one long stream beginning and ending with the word yes. Similar to Siegfried's funeral march, the content of Molly's thoughts are about things that we read about during the day. In other words, her soliloquy is made up of leitmotifs that bring us back to the various parts of the novel. Perhaps most beautiful is when, towards the end of her soliloquy, she recalls her and Bloom sharing a cake. We cannot help but recall Bloom recalling that same event some 13 hours later. Not recognizing that association is like not recognizing that Siegfried is forging Sigmund's sword. The sword is a link between 2 generations. The cake memory symbolizes Molly and Bloom's link to each other. I'm going to play you the opening 2 minutes of Molly's soliloquy, just to give you a flavor of its flow. In this 2-minute excerpt, only the beginning appear on the screen. The beauty is being privy to her internal stream of consciousness.
Yes, because he never did a thing like that before, as us to get his breakfast in bed with a couple of eggs since the City Arms Hotel, when he used to be pretending to be laid up with a sick voice, doing his highness to make himself interesting to that old faggot Mrs. Reardon, that he thought he had a great leg off and she never left us a farthing. All for masses for herself and her soul. Greatest miser ever was, actually afraid to lay out fourpence for her methylated spirit. Telling me all her ailments. She's too much old chat in her about politics and earthquakes and the end of the world. Let us have a bit of fun first. God help the world if all the women were her sort, down on bathing suits and low necks. Of course nobody wanted her to wear. I suppose she was pious because no man would look at her twice. I hope I'll never be like her. I wonder she didn't want us to cover our faces. But she was a well-educated woman, certainly, and her gabby talk about Mr. Reardon here and Mr. Reardon there. I suppose he was glad to get shut of her and her dog smelling my fur and always edging to get up under my petticoats, especially then. Still, I like that in him, polite to old women like that, and waiters, and beggars, too. He's not proud out of nothing, but not always. If ever he got anything really serious the matter with him, it's much better for them to go into hospital where everything is clean. But I suppose I'd have to drink it into him for a month. Yes, and then we'd have a hospital nurse next thing on the carpet, have him staying there till they throw him out, or a nun, maybe, like the smutty photo he has. She's as much a nun as I'm not. Yes, because they're so weak and puling when they're sick, they want a woman to get well. If his nose bleeds, you'd think it was, oh, tragic. And that dying-looking one off the South Circular when he sprained his foot at the choir party at the Sugarloaf Mountain the day I wore that dress. Miss Stack, bringing him flowers, the worst old ones you could find at the bottom of the basket, anything at all to get into a man's bedroom with her old maid's voice, trying to imagine he was dying on account of her.
And on 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 and on. But it's wonderful. I have to repeat what I said a few minutes ago. If you do not notice these recurrences, Ulysses is a good read. If you notice them, it's a great read. Now let's move to Proust's Endless Melodies. He gets four. Now to four examples of Proust's use of literary endless melody. In the interest of time, I'm not going to play or read the first illustration. I'll only show it to you on the screen. Proust can create endless melodies in the form of a stream of consciousness of the same quality as choice. In this excerpt from a 250-word sentence, I've highlighted how the narrator's mind flows from places we've already encountered. The smell of petrol, driving, Albertine's painting, his bedroom, Hawthorne's, cars, a symbol of power, and finally, desiring to have anonymous sex. Proust's endless melodies resemble Joyce's stream of consciousness insofar as the narrative is constructed from leitmotivic material. That is, we recall the prior scenes of each of these references. Proust's sentences, however, are not designed with snippets of his momentary states of consciousness, but rather through long but grammatically correct sentences. Proust's endless melodies are often composed of analogies, metaphors, and a catalog of potential motivations for a specific action or thought. Most writers provide one motivation for a person's action. Proust provides many possible motivations. His reason is that often neither the narrator, as an observing character in the novel, nor the characters themselves know the reasons for their behavior. To illustrate this feature of human psychology, Proust often joins the elements of the sentence with the conjunction or, but not always, as illustrated by our next example. I'm going to read a section midway through the novel. Those of you who are familiar with Monsieur de Chaluse will recognize this description of him. Madame Cottard, by the way, is the wife of a famous physician. You can follow along with the slide on the screen. Madame Cottard, who had been waiting for her husband outside where Monsieur de Chaluse could see her quite well, though he made no effort to summon her, came in and greeted the Baron, who held out his hand to her, as though to a housemaid, without rising from his chair, partly in the manner of a king receiving homage, partly as a snob who does not wish a woman of humble appearance to sit down at his table, partly as an egoist who enjoys being alone with his friends and does not wish to be disturbed. In the following scene, a physician is examining the narrator's grandmother's heart. The physician's motivation is the subject of the sentence. The narrator is proposing four competing explanations for the physician's behavior. From prior encounters with physicians, we know that the narrator has a mixed opinion of physicians. For someone reaching this point in the novel, the reference to Bergotte is the most obvious leitmotif in this 30-second excerpt.
Instead of sounding her chest, fixing on her steadily his wonderful eyes, in which there was perhaps the illusion that he was making a profound scrutiny of his patient, or the desire to give her that illusion, which seemed spontaneous but must be mechanically produced, or else not to let her see that he was thinking of something quite different, or simply to obtain the mastery over her, he began talking about Bergotte.
Don't be fooled into thinking that Proust's sentences are not that difficult to follow. There are some very long sentences in In Search Of. The top five longest sentences in the novel are 958 words, 599 words, which occurs on page 3 of the novel, 477 words, followed by 426 and 398. Our next and final example of a Proustian endless melody is a mere 248 words, of which we'll only look at the first 80 or so words on the screen. Yeah. The audio keeps going. The pause that you will hear after about 2 minutes is a comma, not a period. Remember, this is a 248-word sentence. I suspect that when the audio ends one-third way through the sentence, you will be asking yourself, what on earth is the subject of the sentence?
But when they see another man show a peculiar liking for them, then, whether because they fail to realize that this liking is the same as their own, or because it annoys them to be reminded that this liking, which they glorify so long as it is they themselves that feel it, is regarded as a vice, or from a desire to rehabilitate themselves by a sensational display in circumstances in which it costs them nothing, or from a fear of being unmasked, which they at once recover, as soon as desire no longer leads them blindfold from one imprudence to another, or from rage at being subjected by the equivocal attitude of another person to the injury which, by their own attitude, if that other person attracted them, they would not be afraid to inflict on him.
On first reading, the problem with Proust's endless sentences is that it's very easy to lose sight of the subject of the sentence. In this example we just heard, this fragment of a sentence is part of a larger paragraph which identifies the actual subject. Madame Viardin is puzzled to which person she should offer my arm, to Monsieur de Chalousse or Monsieur de Cambremer, to accompany her into the dining room. Social rank is of utmost importance. She selected the wrong person. The person that Madame Viardin selected recognized that he was of lower rank and therefore should not take Madame Viardin's arm. He rationalized to himself, mistakenly, that Monsieur de Chalousse must be an old friend of the Viardins and therefore won't be offended. In fact, this was Chalousse's first visit to the Viardins. In the same paragraph, Dr. Cottard winks at Chalousse, who misinterprets this as a sexual advance. Now we get treated to a host of different explanations for Chalousse's behavior. Next, Chalousse wonders if Cottard could be interested in Morel, Chalousse's actual lover. Cottard is neither a homosexual nor interested in Morel. The mistakes or misinterpretations are laid on top of each other. It goes on endlessly. And like Wagner's music, we don't want it to end. Joyce and Proust constructed their endless melodies using different linguistic tools, Joyce using the stream of consciousness technique, and Proust often with internal monologue, Joyce with sentence fragments, and Proust with a connective or. Yet both keep their stream and long sentences coherent by using elements to which the reader is familiar, that is, by employing leitmotivic material. Let's take stock of where we are. We're doing well. We have completed 6 of our 8 blocks. Most of you are familiar with the concept of a Gesamtkunstwerk. Since Gesamt means total, Gesamtkunstwerk often is translated as a total work of art. I prefer thinking of it as a synthesis of the arts, where the whole is greater than the sum of its parts. Opera, with its synthesis of libretto, music, conducting, singing, sets, props, blocking, costumes, and lighting, is the ideal form to illustrate the concept of Gesamtkunstwerk. When these components function in unison, the whole truly is greater than the sum of its parts. Let's look at the opening section of Tannhäuser to illustrate operatic Gesamtkunstwerk. This approximate 4-minute excerpt is from the 2017 Paris production. Please note the different artistic elements as they are introduced. Incidentally, we don't get any vocals. They obviously will come in soon. We start with music, then we see it a weird projection of an eye. Who's I? The lighting is black and white. The set is nearly totally barren. Then a dramatic change in lighting. Next we see dancing, waving motions. Another propped. Then the set is transformed into a colorful field. The eye projection, now eyes, are on Tannhäuser. The mood of the music changes. We get another propped, an opium pipe, and then several women walk on stage.
Thank you.
What is the effect on the audience? For me, the answer is clear. I'm not bored. I'm not waiting for the opera to start. Rather, I'm engrossed in the music drama. I want to experience what's going to happen next. In those few minutes, a range of different art forms creates a holistic experience. Can words on a piece of paper, that is literature, create a holistic experience similar, but of course not identical, to opera? More specifically, did Joyce and Proust pull that off? I think they did. What do I got coming up here? Okay, so those are the three question marks to see whether they did or not. For purposes of time, I'm going to discuss Joyce and Proust together, thereby creating a mini Gesamtkunstwerk. And these are the topics which I'll be discussing. First, throughout these two novels, the authors employ multiple writing styles. Joyce, a lover of language, divides his novel into 18 episodes. Each episode mirrors an episode in Homer's Odyssey. Joyce's magnificence is how he captures the tone of where events are occurring. For example, in the Hades episode in Ulysses, it mirrors Odysseus's trip to the underworld. In the Hades episode, we are at a funeral. The language tone is slow and somber. The Sirens episode is filled with music and song and many musical references. You can feel the beat in the language. The Nausicaa episode reads like soft porn and in fact has one and arguably two masturbation scenes. Circe is a goddess of magic and herbs. The Circe episode is written in the style of a surrealistic theatrical play. It takes place in a brothel in which everyone is drunk and hallucinating on the green fairy, that is, absinthe. Linguistically, Ulysses is a Gesamtkunstwerk. Proust also was a master of different writing styles, irony, satire, humor. Certain scenes in Search Of read almost like a play. He was particularly good at parodies. To quote the eminent Proustian William Carter, a parody mimics a writer's use of vocabulary, turn of phrases, and other stylistic hallmarks. The secret was to catch the particular song or rhythm of the original. End of quote. Proust's description of dreams rivals Dali's paintings. His description of jealousy, be it Swans with Odette or the narrator with Albertine, captures a neurotic and psychotic jealous mind better than any psychology book. Within any situation and character, Proust knew how to design different colors, shades, and background. Linguistically, In Search of Lost Time is a Gesamtkunstwerk. Second, both works display incredible encyclopedic knowledge of history, geography, the arts, including painting, folk songs, and operas, the sciences, including physics, optics, and biology, philosophy, literature, world religion, politics, current events, and psychology. Their encyclopedic knowledge moves you through space and time. If you were inclined to look up every reference, you would be a walking Encyclopedia Britannica, or to use a more up-to-date version, a walking Wikipedia. Reading Ulysses and In Search Of is akin to jumping into a kaleidoscope. You move in and out, up and down, and twist it in every direction like an Escher painting. Whether it's a single day in Ulysses or several decades in Search Of, in the minds of Bloom and the narrator, the instances of the novel span hundreds of years and huge geographic distances simultaneously. Both works are epistemological Gesamtkunstwerks. Third, almost every word in every sentence carries multiple layers of meaning. Their novels are akin to cathedrals. Their portrayal of human personality is akin to an archaeological expedition. Each uses time and memory to condense an expanse of space and time into a moment of subjective or psychological perception. Their experience in time becomes so complex, so multi-layered, so impossible to describe one meaning, that for Bloom and the narrator, each moment in time becomes a Gesamtkunstwerk. In his conscious and semi-conscious mental landscape, Bloom is constantly moving in and out of the past, present, and future. Almost every sentence is multi-temporal. Proust does something similar, but at the structural level. Proust structures his novel in two simultaneous time frames, the present and the past being remembered. Both works are semiotic Gesamtkunstwerk. And finally, both Joyce and Proust believe they were describing each and every one of us. I hope each of us believes of ourselves that we are a Gesamtkunstwerk. If Ulysses and In Search of Lost Time do in fact describe us, then these literary works, as is our individual lives, are complete works of art. Our journey is at an end, and it is time to leave Dublin and Paris. I hope you have been enriched with the knowledge and joy gained by our time with James Joyce's Ulysses and Marcel Proust's In Search of Lost Time. I am confident that this talk will motivate you to take the journey into their literary worlds. We return to where we begin with a longer excerpt from Siegfried's Journey Down the Rhine. The music is so joyous that I am going to indulge the full 1 minute and 45 seconds. While this is going on, I'll come around and collect the cards, and then we'll do our little raffle. Nice, isn't it? Okay. Kathy, you want to do the honors? And our, thank you. And our winner is... Kathy Pastor. Karen Pringak. Oh, good. This is the only way I can get rid of all the copies I have. It's Alrighty, how are we doing for time? There was supposed to be an hour and a half. Did I do it? Oh, faster. Good. I'm sure you're saying good too. So, let me. Ah, oh, okay. Oh, to purchase my book, how could I forget that? And I have a couple of flyers up here too, in case you want some. So it's also now on Amazon and ebook. You wouldn't believe how difficult it is to get it on Amazon. They should make it easier. The recordings, if any of you want to read Ulysses, I think it's really helpful, certainly the first time round, to listen to it while you're reading it. This is a free download, the audiobook. Because Joyce, I don't know what the guy's problem was, okay? He wanted to make it really hard for people. So. With the audio, they break up when the person's thinking, when they're saying out loud, who's speaking, because they'll do different voices. So it's just really, really helpful to make sense. And then Naxos audiobooks, they charge for that. But I don't think you need that for Proust. But certainly the audiobook for Ulysses is really helpful. Okay, I will take easy questions. Anything? Yeah.
Who collates the repetitions in Joyce? Did you do that, or is there a regular?
Well, maybe people did, but I, well, okay, so what I did, I really have to thank Christopher Griffiths over there, because he teaches, from Politics and Prose, he teaches Ulysses, I guess, every once a year, you know. So I've taken it four times, at least four times with you, and each time I read it and listened to it, both. And so when I had the idea to do this book, there was no way I could just sit there and think about it. I started reading it with that in mind. And so I just picked out, I mean, I kind of knew going into it the third time, certain recurring things. And the same thing with Proust. I think I read Proust four times. And so when I wrote the book, I wrote with in mind picking out leitmotifs. So I had a notebook, and when I saw it, I just wrote the page number on it. Kept reading it, like, for example, a throwaway, whatever. You know, I just had a notebook. Every time it occurred, I wrote it down. And so I did it that way. And the same thing with Proust, yeah.
Do
Have you thought of, in the very last box, where you were discussing the Gesamtkunst and, but always within literature?
Right.
Had you thought of taking the musical part of the writing and considering it music, if you listen to it, especially since you were listening to it?
Yes, that
and then you have two arts of your
Gesamtkunst. That would have been a fantastic idea, particularly with both of those writers. They both were very musically inclined, and I'm going to call on you in a second, Christopher, to answer the part about Joyce. But Proust actually wanted to write it as a musical score, just straight across. He's hard enough, but with no paragraphs. He doesn't have that many paragraphs to start out with. You know, they go on forever. But he just wanted to just read like a musical score, so it was very musical in his mind. But his editors, I guess, said, you can't do that. You know, the viewer needs a break every now and then. But yeah, that would be a fantastic... Christopher, do you have anything to say about Ulysses? I know Joyce was so musical.
Yeah, Joyce was very musical. He did begin as a singer. His mother and father were singers. And in some ways, he sort of wooed Nora by singing at the age of 22 in Dublin. He sang Yeats's Down by the Selly Gardens. They competed against a guy called John McCormack and came in second in the festival and figured, well, if I can't be Ireland's greatest singer, I'll be Ireland's greatest novelist. And when they were in Trieste, he had a wife and two kids, and sometimes he'd go to the opera rather than buy food. Like Traviata was on six nights in a row, he'd go there. Sometimes he would bring Nora. And as Bill mentioned, there's 18 chapters, episodes in Ulysses. The Sirens episode is very musical. And of course, it's based on the Odyssey, where the sirens are singing on the rocks, trying to get the sailors to come close and get drowned on the rocks. And Ulysses wants to hear the music, so he gets the sailors to tie him to the mast. So when he goes crazy with the music, he doesn't dive into the waves. And he gets the sailors to block their ears with wax so they can do their job and not go crazy. The beginning of the Sirens episode looks like gibberish, but what it is, it's the chapter of music with kind of broken up into atomic particles, and there's a do, re, and mi of it. You've got to skip to the second page to see, okay, now it starts to make more sense. Joyce's father is a character in that chapter, a pretty nasty character, but he sort of redeems himself by his singing and his playing of the piano in that chapter. So it is a musical composition. I think Anthony Burgess tried to do an opera based on Ulysses. And I think John Cage did an oratorio based on Finnegan's Wake called Roratorio. So Joyce was very musical. And of course, he did study Wagner. And what was one of his dismissals of Wagner was, Wagner stinks of sex.
Right, yeah, yeah. And I'm being facetious, but Joyce is writing, says that while he's writing the masturbation scene. And
I mentioned that particular free recording is about 36 hours long and was done by Irish National Public Radio 40 years ago for the Joyce Centenary in 1982. This year is the centenary of Ulysses being published. It was published on his 40th birthday. So this is now his 140th birthday. But Irish National Public Radio did that recording with lots of different actors. They spent months doing it. And one of the songs Molly Bloom sings is Lachi Derem from Don Giovanni. So in that recording, every reference to Lachi Derem, you hear it. So it's polyphonic and it's very, total to hear.
Right, yeah. Yeah. Yes, it's free. Yeah, but the thing you mentioned, which is such a fantastic project, but I can't do it. I'm not going to do it. Yes?
There's a free version of the first volume of In Search of Lost Time available via LibriVox if people wanted to hear Swan's Way for free on the recording. It's very good. But question for you. Okay, so you have Joyce and you have Proust. If you had to add an additional musician who followed Wagner, who would you add as somebody who's, you know, worthy of it?
Gosh, I wish Jeffrey Swan was here. Mark seems to know everything. I don't know how he does it, but that's a big buildup for you. What are you going to do?
I would say, oddly enough, Alban Berg. He took an entirely, it's not the Wagnerian romanticism and scope, it's an entirely different musical language which forces you, to start to listen to musical fragments in order to really follow the meaning.
Right. Is that 12-tone music?
12-tone.
Yeah, right. Yeah, it just isn't like chunks of little, it's not like Mozart, or something,
You don't leave the theater humming.
Yes. Anything else? Swan's Way is actually very easy to read, comparatively speaking. And then it has the first several pages, what people say. It has all the leitmotifs that are going to be, all the terms that become leitmotifs for the rest of the novel, in Cambrai. In fact, it's called, in answer to your question, it's called the overture. The first section of In Search of, the first, I don't know, 20 pages. Depending on the print, because they're different editions, so it could be like, mine I think is like 20 pages, and the other's probably 100 pages. It's called overture. Yeah.
Is In Search of originally written in French and translated?
Yes. If so,
how much does the translation into English affect some of these insights and conclusions?
Oh, I wish William Carter was here. Okay, so William Carter is this big name. He's a Proustian scholar. He's sort of like, I don't know. And he says the Moncrief translation is just really very, very good. Now, he's doing another translation of it, but it's really based on, it's an annotation. So it's based on Moncrief's, and he just sort of, Moncrief was British. So he just changes some of the words and tweaks a little. But my understanding is the Moncrief translation is just really great. I mean, there might be some things, but by and large, it's just fantastic. Has anybody heard otherwise? I don't speak French, and so I can't hold them side by side, but just what I've heard.
I listened to the audiobook in French, and even though it was very dense, the language itself is very sort of basic or simple, so that when you're listening to it, you can really follow it, And so I'm thinking, maybe your translation would not be as difficult for that reason. Maybe because French is my first language. Yeah. So to me, it felt very natural when I was listening to it. Mm. And I was wondering, there was a part of the book where they discussed a concert, like it was a piano recital.
Vente's it's a septet it becomes, but it was a, the musical Vente's piece, I'm going blank on it, is really crucial to the, that's a gigantic leitmotif. Vente's, it becomes a septet, sonata, I don't know, my mind is getting fuzzy. Yeah, music's very, very important. Well, to Ulysses, there's songs all the time, people are singing songs. And in Proust as well, there's Wagner's referred to all the time. 116 times or something. And Proust's longest analysis of aesthetics is from Wagner, describing Wagner. Other questions? Well, okay. Do you want me to close it or do you want to close it?
No, please go.
Well, I hope you enjoyed it. I really enjoyed putting this together. I wrote the book over when we were quarantined, which is sort of weird. At first, I wrote it just sort of for fun because we were homebound. And then people sort of liked it, people being my wife. And so then I expanded it for the second version. I did the first edition just to get it done, just because I thought it'd be really cool to have a book. And then, but it just left out a lot of stuff because I had a certain deadline to get it done. And then when that happened and people liked it, I thought, well, okay, then I'm going to put a lot more meat to it. Christian is here. Let me ask you this question, and it's sort of relevant, I guess. Joyce really, like you said, Dante and Shakespeare, Homer, you know, those people. And so now I'm working through Dante's Divine Comedy. So the question is, what my thought is that he really liked Dante and Shakespeare was because they invented a lot of words. I know they're really great hallmarks of English and Italian, but they also made up a lot of words.
Yeah, Joyce himself is a lord of language, as was Dante. I mean, you know, the Tuscan dialect that Dante used for the Divine Comedy, set in the year 1300, certainly became the standard dialect for Italian. And, of course, Shakespeare in the Elizabethan Jacobean period, you know, the amount of words that were just around for him to draw on. And Shakespeare probably even invented some words that didn't exist before, like, you know, Macbeth, washing his bloody hands, says, you know, I could make the oceans incarnate. So, you know, for Joyce, his competitors were not contemporary novelists. They were the Bible, Homer, Dante, and Shakespeare. Again, lords of language.
All righty. Well, I hope you got a... I hope this makes you, draws you to picking up Ulysses through Politics and Prose and In Search of Lost Time. And, of course, Wagner. You can never have enough Wagner. All right, thank you.